Stephen Lilley from Greencoat UK Wind is with me in the studio today. Stephen, nice to see you.
Likewise.
A steady first half here for you. I mean, first quarter particularly strong, eased back a touch in the second quarter.
Yeah, we had strong production in Q1. You probably remember the beast from the east. That certainly was helpful for us, both in terms of production, but also in terms of power price capture as well. Second quarter off a little bit. I think we normally expect 30% of production in the first quarter and 20% in the second quarter anyway, so that's not too surprising. In the total for the half, we were 6% down on production at 951 gigawatt hours. We currently produce power for 725,000 homes. That's the sort of size of what that really means. Power prices in the quarter were in the half were up as well. So the two sort of really offset each other. So cash generation for the half was pretty much on budget at 67.4 million, and that's a comparison to last year of just over 39. So we're 72%. We calculated higher than this time last year, or an increase in 72%. I should say. And that's just the size of the business, the number of acquisitions we did last year, and obviously the cash generation that they throw off.
That's right. So you're at 30 wind farms now.
30 wind farms, 785 megawatts. So that's gone up from 6 5 years ago at listing to 30. So that's five. My maths is correct, five times. and from 127 to 785 megawatts. I can't quite do the maths on that off the top of my head, but. Yes, about five times bigger than we were 5 years ago.
Because I think the last time you and I spoke was around the time of the beast from the east, and not too long afterwards you made the acquisition of
Brockaghboy. Yes, the Brockaghboy in Northern Ireland. Nice, did a big asset in Northern Ireland, a big wind farm in Northern Ireland. We bought that. Delighted with that. So that's our 30th different investment. We spent £163 million for all of that, so 100% of that. And then later in the half, we exercised our option for Clyde, so we increased our shareholding back up to 28.2%, which was the original percentage that we bought it before the mechanical dilution when the extension came into being. So we again own 28.2%. I think it's a 522 megawatt wind farm, up from 350 when we bought it originally. So delighted with that. It was a very easy decision to exercise that option. It's been a wind farm that's produced more than we expected from day one. So we're delighted with that, and a really nice cooperative relationship with SSE. So great wind farm, very easy decision.
And around the time of that acquisition, of course, you had that quite significant fundraise, $218
million. Yeah, really just managing the balance sheet. I mean, it looked as if we were doing it to buy Clyde, if you like, but actually we just, any time in the year, we were trying to work out what we want our gearing to be, and we knew the transaction was going to happen. Obviously, we signalled that as part of the fundraising process. We could have done it afterwards, but actually it's just a good time to do it. Manage the balance sheet, and at the end of that we're 23% geared, which is in our 20 to 30% range. We only could raise 10% of the shareholder register because we did it without a prospectus, so we could only issue £119 million worth of stock. We were heavily oversubscribed, so very frustrated, if you like, not to have satisfied demand, but hopefully looked after our current shareholders well and gave them a pretty good allocation, but delighted with that. Good transaction, good fundraise, and sets us up nicely for the next few months ahead.
Well, speaking of the next few months ahead, what are the plans? What are you hoping to achieve in the second half?
Well, it's been an interesting half because not least we did a transaction and then increased our exposure to Clyde. We've seen a number of transactions in the market take place at a higher price than we would pay for them, and I think we've seen this in the last 5 years from time to time, where different parts of what is a very big market, we estimate about £50 billion worth of operating UK wind farms, parts of that market get hot from time to time, and so that's fine, we just don't buy in that part of the market. I think the benefit of us having, I think, bought from either 11 or 12 different sellers now is that we look across the whole market, and if we see prices are too expensive in certain parts of that, we'll just keep out of it for a time being. And it's amazing how it sort of swaps around a little bit. And I think for us, having the capability or the mandate, if you like, to buy wind farms on without gearing on at a project level, it makes life somewhat easier, and it makes us capable of buying from the whole market. So we'll look at everything, and sometimes we'll spectacularly lose to people who we feel that want to pay far more for an asset than we want to. We don't think it's necessarily that the market is the UK wind market is just becoming more expensive. We just think there's pockets of it that move around a little bit, depending on what investors are seeking at any particular time.
So if need be, you're more than happy to take a slow and steady approach
and acquire
at the right price.
Absolutely. And I think that's the sort of the corollary to what I've just said, isn't it?
Exactly.
We'll just hang on and wait. We did from August 2014 to December 2015 not buy anything. So it was 15 months of not doing anything. Well, we did quite a lot. And we certainly looked at a lot of investments, but we didn't buy anything in that period because we thought prices were high for anything that came into the market. Now, the nice thing a few years on is that actually it's a much bigger market. So there's always wind farms that various people want to sell stakes in or sell on in total. So it's just a bigger market. We see more opportunity.
And we're in it now, the third quarter. Stephen, how's that got off for you?
Well, beginning of July, you won't be surprised to hear, has been not particularly windy. Mm. I think the benefit of having an exposure across the whole of the UK is that actually have production, just because you happen to be in a spot, i.e. London, most of the time where it could be quite quiet. It doesn't mean to say that the north of Scotland isn't blowing, which it is today, actually. Same with Northern Ireland. So I think we've seen a few days of calm. The weekend, not that we judge our business based on the odd day, obviously a bit more production, and we would expect, as we've had for the whole of our 5 years of existence, that production will be on budget. It has been for 5 years. I can't see why it would change particularly.
Stephen, great to see you. Thanks very much.
Thank you.